Live from Vancouver, Canada, it's theCUBE. Covering OpenStack Summit North America 2018. Brought to you by Red Hat, the OpenStack Foundation, and its ecosystem partners.
The sun has come out, but we're still talking about a lot of the clouds here at the OpenStack Summit 2018 in Vancouver. I'm Stu Miniman with my co-host, John Troyer. Happy to welcome to the program the 2018 Super User Award winner, George Mihaiescu, who's the Senior Cloud Architect with the Ontario Institute for Cancer Research, OICR. First of all, congratulations.
Thank you very much for
having
me.
And thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
So cancer research obviously is one of those things we talk about, is how can technology really help us at a global standpoint, help people. So tell us a little about the organization first.
Absolutely.
Before we get into the tech of it.
So OICR is the largest cancer research institution in Canada and is funded by Government of Ontario. Located in Toronto, we support about 1,700 researchers, trainees, and clinicians, staff, and it's focused entirely on cancer research. It's located in a hub of cancer research in downtown Toronto with Princess Margaret Hospital, SickKids Hospital, Mount Sinai, very, very powerful research centers, and the OICR basically interconnects all these research centers and tries to bring together and to advance cancer research in the province, in Canada, and globally.
That's fantastic, George. So with that, sketch out for us a little bit your role, kind of the purview that you have and the scope of what you cover.
So I was hired 4 years ago by OICR to build and design a cloud environment based on a research grant that was awarded to a number of principal investigators in Canada to build this cloud computing infrastructure that can be used by cancer researchers to do large-scale analysis. What happens with cancer, because the variety of the mutations happening in cancer patients, researchers found that they cannot just analyze a few samples and draw a conclusion, because the conclusion wouldn't be actually valid. So they needed to do large-scale research. And the ICGC, which is International Cancer Genome Consortium, an organization that's made of 17 countries that are donating, collecting and analyzing data from cancer patients, okay, they decided to put together all this data and to align it uniformly using the same algorithm and then analyze it using the same workflows in order to actually draw a conclusion that's valid across multiple data sets. And for they are focusing on the 50 most common types of cancers, okay, that affect most people in this world. And for each type of cancer, at least two countries provide and collect data. So for brain cancer, let's say you have data sets from two countries, for melanoma, for skin, for. And this basically gives you better confidence that the conclusion you draw is valid. And then the more pieces you of the puzzle you throw on the table, the easier to see the big picture that's this cancer.
Yeah, George, I mean, as I'm a former academic, and you know, the more data you get, right, the more infrastructure you're going to have. I'm just reading off the little the announcement, right, 2,600 cores, 18 terabytes of RAM, 7.3 petabytes of storage, right? Mm-hmm. That's a lot of data, and it's a lot of accessed by a lot of different researchers.
Yes.
When you came in, did was the decision to use OpenStack already made, or did you make that decision, and how was the cloud architected in that way?
So the decision was basically made to use open source. We wanted basically to spend the money on capacity, on hardware, on research, not on licensing and support.
Good use of everybody's so tax dollars.
Exactly,
yeah.
So you cannot do that. Like, if you have to spend money for paying licensing, then you probably have only build half of the capacity that you could. So that means less large analysis and longer it takes and more costly. So Ceph for storing the data sets and OpenStack for the infrastructure as a service offering was a no-brainer. And my specialty was in OpenStack and Ceph. I started OpenStack 7 years ago, so I was hired to design and build. And I had the chance to actually do alignment and mutation calling for some of the data sets. So I was able to monitor the kind of stress that these workflows put on the system. So when I designed it, I knew what is important and what to focus on. So it's a cloud environment that's customized for cancer research. We have very good ratio of RAM per CPU. We have very large local disks for the VM, for the virtual machines, to be able to download very large data sets. We build it so if one compute node fails, you only impact a few workflows running there. You don't impact single small points of failures and other tunings that we apply to the system too.
Yeah. George, can you walk us through a little bit of the stack? Mm-hmm. What do you use? Do you build your own sure. OpenStack, or do you get it from someone?
Yeah, so basically we use commodity hardware. We just high-density chassis, currently from Supermicro, Ubuntu for the operating system, no licensing there, OpenStack from Debian packages. We focus more on stability, scalability, and support cost, internal support cost, because it's just myself, and I have a colleague, Jared Baker, who's a cloud engineer, and we have to support all this environment, so we try to focus on the features that are more most useful to our users, as well as less strain on our time and support resources.
Yeah, that's, I mean, talk about the scalability, right? Mm-hmm. You said it's the team is you and a colleague,
yes.
Mostly, right? Mm-hmm. And you know, in the olden days, right, you would be taking care of maybe a handful of machines and maybe some disk arrays in the lab, mm-hmm. but now you're basically servicing an entire infrastructure for all of Canada, right?
Yes.
At how many universities?
Well, basically it's a global. So we have 40 research projects from four continents. So we have from Australia, from Israel, from China, from Europe, US, Canada. So approved cancer researchers that can access the data, open up an account with us, and they get a quota, and they start their virtual machines. They download the data sets from the S3 API of Ceph, okay, to the VMs, and they do analysis, and we charge them for the time used. And because we use everything is open source, and no, we don't pay any licensing fees, we are able to, and we don't are not for profit, we charge them just the cost that it costs us to be able to replenish the hardware when it fails.
Nice, okay. Nice. And these are actually very large machines, right? Because you have to have huge, thick data sets. You've got big data sets you have to compare all at once.
I mean, on average, BAM is called a file that has like the normal DNA of the patient, and they need also the tumor DNA, okay, from the biopsy. An average whole genome sequenced is about 150 gigabytes. So they need at least 300 gigabytes. And depending on the analysis, if they find the mutations, then the output is usually 5-10 gigabytes, so much smaller. For other workflows, you have to actually align the data. So you input 150 gigabytes, and the output is 150 or a bit more with metadata. Okay. So nevertheless, you need a very large storage for the virtual machines. And these are virtual machines that run very hot. In terms of, like, you cannot do a CPU over subscription. You cannot do memory over subscription. When you have a workflow that runs for 4 days, 100% CPU. So it's different than other web scale environments where you have web servers running at 10%, you can do 10-to-1 subscription, and then you go much cheaper or different solutions. Here you have to only provide what you have physically, okay? And
that's great.
Yeah. George, you've mm-hmm. said you participated in the OpenStack community for about 7 years now.
Yes.
What kind of, do you actually contribute code? Mm-hmm. What pieces are you active in the community?
Yeah, so I'm not a developer. My background is in networking, system administration, and security. But I was involved in OpenStack since the beginning, before it was a foundation. I went to the first OpenStack public conference in Boston 7 years ago, the International Intercontinental Hotel. And over time, I was involved in discussions on the IRC channel, mailing list support, reporting bugs. Even recently, we had very interesting bug that affected us where the CloudInit package that is supposed to resize the disk of the VM as it boots, it was not using more than 2 terabytes because there was a bug, okay? So we reported this, and Scott Mosser, who's the maintainer of the Cloud Utils package, worked on the bug, and 2 days later, we had a fix, and Canonical built the package. It's in the latest Cloud Ubuntu image, and Red Hat and everybody else is going to use the same version of the package. So somebody who now has larger than 2 terabyte VMs, when they boot, they will be able to resize and use the entire disk. Mm-hmm. And that's just an example of how, with open source, you can achieve things that take much longer in a commercial distribution, where even if you pay, doesn't necessarily mean that the response.
Yeah, sure. Well, so George, any lessons learned? You've been with us a long time, right? And you, like Seth, one thing we noticed that today in the keynote is actually a lot of the storage networking, virtual storage networking and compute wasn't really talked about. Those projects were maybe down focused a bit as they talked about all the connectivity to everything else. So, I mean, any lessons? So, my point is, the infrastructure is stable of OpenStack, but any lessons learned along the journey?
I think the lessons are that you can definitely build very affordable and useful and scalable infrastructure, but you have to get your expectations right. We only use from the OpenStack the projects that we consider are stable enough, so we can support them confidently without spending. Like if a project is adds 5% value to your offering, okay, but it's 80% of your time debugging and trying to get it working, it doesn't have packages and missing documentation and so on, that's maybe not a good fit for your environment if you don't have the manpower to, and if it's not absolutely needed. Another very important lesson is that you have to really stay up to date. Like, go to the conferences, read the emails on the emails on the mailing list, be active in the community. We host the OpenStack meetups in Toronto for the 2018. We present there. We talk to other members. In these 7 years, I read thousands, tens of thousands of emails. So I learn from other users' experiences. I try to help where I can. You have to be involved with the developers. I know the Ceph core developer, Sage, and other people. So you can't do this just by staying on the side and looking. You have to be involved. And
yeah, George, what are you looking for next from this community? Or you talked about the stability. Or are there pieces that you're hoping reach that maturity threshold for yourselves, or new functionalities that you're looking for down the road?
I think for what we want to provide to our researchers, because they don't run web scale applications, so their needs are a little bit different. We want to add Magnum to our environment to allow them deploy a Kubernetes cluster easily. We want to add Octavia to expose the services, even though they don't run many web services, but you have to find a way to expose them when they run them. Maybe Trove, database as a service. We'll see if we can deploy it safely and if it's stable enough. Anything that OpenStack comes up with, we basically look, is it useful? Is it stable? Can we do it? And we try it.
Right. So, George, last thing, your group is the Super User of the Year. Can you just walk us through that journey? What led to the nomination? What does it mean to your team to win?
I think we are a bit surprised because we are a very small team and our scale is not as high because T-Mobile or the other members, but I think it shows that, for a big company to be able to deploy OpenStack and scale and make it work, it's maybe not very surprising because, yes, they have the resources, they have a lot of manpower and a lot of... but for a small institutional organization or smaller company to be able to do it without involving a vendor, without involving extra costs, I think that's the thing that was appreciated by the community and by the OpenStack Foundation. And we are pretty excited to have won it.
All right, George, let me give you the final word. As somebody that's been involved with the community for a while, what would you say to people if they're, you know, still maybe looking from the outside or played with it a little bit? What tips would you give them?
I think that we are living proof that it can be done. And if you wait until things are perfect, then they will never be. Okay. Even Google has services in beta. Amazon has services in beta. You have to install OpenStack. It's much more performant and stable than when I started with OpenStack, where there was just a few projects. But definitely, they will get help from the community, and the documentation is much better. Just go and do it. Well, you won't regret it.
George, as we know, software will eventually work, hardware will eventually fail.
So, absolutely.
George Mihaiescu, congratulations to OICR on the Super User of the Year Award. For John Troyer, I'm Stu Miniman. We're getting towards the end of day one of 3 days of wall-to-wall coverage here at OpenStack Summit 2018 in Vancouver. Thanks so much for watching theCUBE.
Thank you.